So if you're concerned with consuming excess phytoestrogens, goitrogens, which goitrogens are things that block the uptake of certain minerals in your thyroid gland, and if you're concerned with consuming mineral chelators, which basically cause micronutrient deficiencies in general, then you may want to strongly reconsider eating beans. Now, beans of all types have been proven. There are compounds in these beans, which I'm going to show you the research today, have been proven to be bad for reproductive hormone function, bad for thyroid function as goitrogens, and also be very, very rich in certain mineral chelators that are very well known to pull essential minerals out of the body and cause micronutrient deficiencies. In today's video, I'm going to explore this reality. I'm going to show you this research and show you the truth about beans and why you probably want to stop eating beans if you care about your health. First off, I think it's really important that we identify exactly what good health actually is, because a lot of people say, this or that is healthy, but what they don't have is a framework to operate under. And so I've identified a framework, something that I don't think people can really disagree with. I think this is extremely fundamental, the way the body works, the way human biology works. This is independent of any dogmatic diets or diet cults and that sort of stuff, identity-based diets. This is kind of on another level above it. So the basics here, the body is in good health when two conditions are met. Now, the first condition is that the body must not have micronutrient deficiencies. Now, the micronutrients are the vitamins and minerals that are essential in the body for the body to use in all metabolic and hormonal processes, from the cellular level to tissues, organs, organ systems, and just to have the whole organism functioning properly. This is quite basic, quite foundational, and I've been talking about this for years. Now, the second thing is hormonal balance. The body is truly healthy when you bring it into a state of hormonal balance. Now, there are there's two classes of hormones in the body. So there's stress hormones and protective hormones. Now, stress hormones, some examples could be, but aren't limited to, cortisol, estrogen, SHBG, and prolactin. In terms of protective hormones, we have like basically thyroid hormones, and reproductive hormones like testosterone, growth hormone, progesterone, that sort of thing. So what you want, what's really important, is that the ratios are balanced between these different hormones. You see that when you read the medical literature, you see how important these ratios truly are to the state of good health in the body. Now, if you disagree that the body doesn't need these vitamins and minerals to function properly, that the body can be healthy with deficiencies, and if you disagree that the body doesn't need to be hormonally balanced, if you don't think that we should have good, healthy levels of reproductive hormones and thyroid hormones, but we should have high levels of stress hormones, if you think these things, then fundamentally you and I disagree on what health means. And that's fine, and you can go on and live your life, and good luck. Have fun. So, but on the other hand, if you do agree with me, then you will see that now we have a framework to operate within. We have something that can help us define what is truly healthy and what is not healthy. And in doing this and examining all of the research around beans and legumes in general, I've come to the conclusion, the non-dogmatic and just objective conclusion, that beans are not healthy for the body. So in this study right here, the researchers show that under soy, legumes actually have the highest phytoestrogen content per 100 grams of any food. And this is important. If you've watched any of my other videos talking about phytoestrogens, there's a massive amount of proof and evidence that phytoestrogens actually do act as estrogens in the body. It's been proven that they do bind to estrogen receptors and activate downstream estrogenic effects in the body. So the phytoestrogen content is very important to note. There are a lot of phytoestrogens in beans. Now, this study shows that there are actually four different types of estrogens that are present in the flowering bean plant. Now, the study right here states that these phytoestrogens actually have a very, very strikingly similar molecular structure to that of endocrine disruptors, like BPA, for example. And BPA is very well known to be a very potent endocrine disruptor. The study right here shows that legume extracts have high levels of estrogenic activity. Now, what they said is that they have competitive binding, significant competitive binding to estrogen receptor beta. Estrogen activity was determined using an estrogen-dependent MCF7 breast cancer cell proliferation assay. The extracts displayed increased cell proliferation above levels observed with estradiol. That's scary. The pure estrogen antagonist, ICI 182780, that's an estrogen antagonist, suppressed cell proliferation induced by these extracts, which would suggest that an estrogen receptor-related signaling pathway is involved with consuming these things. Now, all seven of the extracts exhibited preferential agonist activity, which means they boosted the estrogenic activity, essentially, toward the estrogen receptor beta. So that's some pretty good proof right there. So this study right here on legumes shows a very significant effect on the impact of birth on multiple species of animals. Now, this dissertation, actually, from UNH, looked at different plants and the effects that they have on the reproductive systems of several animals. Basically, what they determined was there was a very large-scale influence of legumes, i.e. beans, on the estrogenic activity in the body of those animals that were studied, significantly with uterine weights, which I talk about in the flaxseed video too. It's a really bad sign when you see an increase in the uterine weight or like prostatic growth and that sort of thing. So this study right here, or this piece of content right here, actually shows that legumes produced infertility on female mice. Here we have some research showing that uterine enlargement was found when looking at the phytoestrogen effect on the thyroid. So it's interesting. They're linking this uterine growth to the goitrogenic activity from the thyroid, the dysfunction in the thyroid. And that makes sense because all of these things are connected. The body is one big system. It's not, these things aren't isolated. They're not functioning in a vacuum. So this study right here, they looked at the very important anti-nutritive factors in these legumes. There's quite a bit of them. In this one, actually, right here, they show a massive effect of goitrogens from these beans on the animals that eat them, and that's confirmed. Now, and if all these endocrine-disrupting properties of beans aren't bad enough, we also find that beans have some of the highest content of a compound known as phytic acid, which is an extremely well-known mineral chelator. It has actually been gone so far as two researchers that did an entire review of the entire base of medical literature on phytic acid and minerals. They determined that the phytic acid consumption in the human population is likely the single greatest factor and reason why across the world almost all humans are massively deficient in certain micronutrients. Phytic acid is a really strong chelator of minerals, meaning it really easily binds to many essential minerals. And this is helpful within the plant itself, since this is an evolutionary design meant to help the plant store a lot of its own minerals. However, the plant stores its minerals in the indigestible part of the plant or the grain as a natural defense mechanism, such as the bran of rice, for example. So even during human consumption, the human gut typically cannot actually digest and get access to these stored minerals, for example, in brown rice. The phytic acid, however, poses an issue to the human body since it still chelates minerals when humans consume it. It's chelating minerals within the human system, especially in large amounts. Now, some researchers have gone so far, like I said, to assert that humans should not consume phytic acid, and its consumption in the human body is responsible for population-scale micronutrient deficiencies of nearly every essential vitamin and mineral. Now, in this book right here, you find that they state the fact that the strong chelating effect of phytic acid is shown that it basically forms insoluble compounds with many of these essential minerals, including, but not limited to, copper, cobalt, magnesium, manganese, zinc, calcium, and iron. These are extremely common mineral deficiencies in the body. Now, of course, this would also mean that vegans and vegetarians are vastly more susceptible to wide-scale vitamin and mineral deficiencies due to their high intake of phytic acid-containing foods. Now, hopefully, this isn't a bit too concerning. I know when I did a video mentioning beans and how they're not necessarily healthy for you within this thought framework of what true health really means, I know a lot of people are concerned because there are a lot of cultural differences. There's a lot of cultural foods based around dishes with beans and consuming legumes. That is not, just because there's a cultural tradition doesn't mean that the food isn't healthy. So the issue here is that there's a lot of confusion around what to eat and what not to eat. So what I did is I actually went back and I made this framework. I've been studying this stuff for over 10 years now. Cured myself naturally, healed myself naturally of my severe health problems. So I've seen the patterns, and I'm quite frankly pretty obsessed with this stuff, and I like to solve problems, and this is a major problem to solve. So what I did is I made a tool that basically asks you a couple key questions. And these questions are a bit unorthodox. These are not things that even your doctor would ask you. They're unorthodox because they trigger certain things. I've seen these patterns, and this works. There are three organs in the human body that when they are out of whack, they throw the health out of whack. They start to, and they're typically, they go out of whack because of these certain mineral deficiencies and hormonal imbalances. So I'm gonna help you identify which body type you are. If you go to thethermodiet.com/quiz, I've got a quiz built for you just to ask a few simple questions. We're gonna identify whether you're a liver body type, whether you're a thyroid body type, or whether you're a pituitary body type. And then I'm gonna put you on a fast track to help bridge that gap and really heal yourself, bring yourself back to baseline, heal that organ and that organ system properly. And what you're gonna see is you're gonna come back into this hormonal balance. You're gonna have more energy than ever. You're gonna sleep deeply. You're gonna have amazing libido, more strength. You're gonna get lean more easily. And this is all tenets of this system that I'm calling thermo, the thermo diet. So if you go over to thethermodiet.com/quiz, I'll have a link in the description as well. Just answer a few questions. I'll help you get on your way. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to this channel. I'll see you on the next video. All right, so what's the claim? The claim here that the myth basically is that you have only a specific window to eat in.